Hello everyone. Today we talk about efficiency and range. So far we had some theoretical numbers from simulation. And now we have real measurement data, right? We have those 18 series validation vehicles. They are doing a lot of tests, like crash tests and some other stuff. And one vehicle, SVC3-1, did some efficiency and range measurements. And we want to explain to you today what are the results. And I think we have some good news, right? And this is what we want to explain. We start a little with the rough information and then Olli goes more and more into the detail. We did the measurements at our testing and development partner here in the greater area of Munich. We did the test several times. We did some interpretation of the data, and this is what we are going to explain now. What is efficiency? Maybe we should explain first. Efficiency is how much energy in terms of kilowatt hours you need to have in order to drive 100 kilometers. Yeah, those are numbers like 14, 15, 16, whatever, 20 kilowatt hours for 100 kilometers. That's efficiency. Range is something completely different. Range says, how far can I drive with my vehicle? Battery capacity, for example, then plays a role. We have here a 54 kilowatt hour battery in the vehicle, and with that efficiency, we will later come on, we can drive a certain distance, yeah, considering that we cannot use 100% of the battery capacity. That's important. Now you see a diagram in the background. We have again price and our more or less 30,000 euro for the Sion, and here we have the range. And we can now say we have validated 305 kilometers with our measurements, which Olli will later talk about more into detail. And this is the plug-in range with our battery capacity, 54 kilowatt hours, LFP battery. But you cannot use, as mentioned before, the entire amount of 54 kilowatt hours. You only can use a net value of that. So that's one very important dot, 305 kilometers, check. Yeah. And now it's becoming interesting. We have a second dot for the Sion. This is an extended range if we consider the weekly solar yield transformed into range. So then we have a weekly range of the vehicle of 417 kilometers. And that means the 112 kilometers assumed per week are also now validated with that specific consumption, right? And that's also really good news, especially for our USP solar skin utilizing the solar yield. Okay, let's come out with the numbers, right? First number, 14.5 kilowatt hours per 100 kilometers specific consumption, which is the efficiency, if we do not consider the charging losses. Electric vehicles always have charging losses. They are all different between vehicles. Yeah, we think we have quite low charging losses. We can later explain why. That's the number 14.5. Second number, 16.1 kilowatt hours per 100 kilometers if we consider the charging losses. And this is what most car OEMs communicate, the specific consumption with the charging losses. So here we are exactly in the target. We prognosed earlier, I think around 16.4 kilowatt hours per 100 kilometers. So we really made it on the point. Now validated by measurements, not only simulation. One more number I need to provide for now. So, and this is the 5,800 kilometers that we gain from the sun per year. Because with that efficiency of the vehicle, the specific consumption, we also know really how much we can gain by the sun, so by the solar PV skin. And this is also validated now by measurement, so it's not only simulated. And later when we go into the details, Olli will explain why we are so sure that we can communicate those numbers now. We have some conservatively taken assumptions. That's, in our opinion, very important to be conservative on that, not to promise too much, but we come to that later, right? Now, let's go a little into a comparison. In the diagram, in the graph behind me, you can see price and specific consumption. With our Sion vehicle, we are around 30,000 euro, so quite low, on the lower end of all those vehicles. With a specific consumption of 16.1 kilowatt hours per 100 kilometers, gross, including charging losses, we are also still very good. So the combination of specific consumption and sales price is really, really good. Yeah, that's one important thing to consider, referring to specific consumption. The other one is, on this graph you can see now, again, we have the price here, 30,000 again for our Sion, and here we have the range. We also validated the range, and we are very sure we can make it to 305 kilometers with one battery charging, and probably even more, and later we will explain why, even more, and why we are confident. And also this combination is really good, how you can see compared to our peers, and that brings a lot of value for your money if you buy that Sion. So knowing this now, Olli, what did we do to come to those really, really good results?
Good question. What did we do? So after SVC2, we built up a vehicle performance and simulation model. So a model representative of the SVC3 Sion. That model consists of a vehicle driver model, vehicle dynamics model, and then our SVC3 hardware. So models that are representative of our high voltage battery, distribution and charging unit, electric drive unit, thermal system, and then our vehicle controls. And what we do with that model is we feed it inputs. Inputs such as drive cycles, mm-hmm. something like an efficiency drive cycle, mm-hmm. but also a performance drive cycle, or even a charging drive cycle. Yep. We also specify what the ambient temperature is, mm-hmm. what is the soak temperature of all the components. And then last but not least, we plug in the vehicle driving resistances. So things like vehicle weight, rolling resistance, and vehicle drag, so aerodynamics, how slippy is the vehicle in the air.
Yeah. And that's a model, right? So until a few months ago, we have been working on models, they are simulation models, and now we made something completely different, right?
That's right. So with that, in that virtual world, with that model, when we run these drive cycles and charging cycles, we get outputs. Things like vehicle consumption, which you were talking about, vehicle range, performance, so 0 to 100 kph times, high speed cruise results, charging times, other things like thermal data, so how warm is our battery getting, our EDU during these drive cycles, and a lot of very important high voltage data as well. Mm-hmm. What does this model allow us to do? It allows us to virtually validate our vehicle targets, our attribute targets, such as the driving range, WLTP, charge times, high speed cruise, these types of things, as well as already start optimizing thermal control strategies virtually before we test the vehicle.
Right, and this is what we did so far. We only had the virtual world. This is why we could came up with a range prognosis and also a specific consumption prognosis, right? And now we have real vehicles, yeah? We see one of those 18 vehicles here. And by the way, this is one which will later go to the public road and confirm what we are talking about here even more realistically. So now we have hardware, right? What does
that help? Exactly, good question. So with that vehicle model, we're able to build confidence in our declared range and consumption numbers. We felt comfortable with the numbers. Then we went and built an SVC3 physical vehicle. The first thing we needed to do after commissioning was validate the driving resistances, make sure that those inputs we'd been feeding into the model were valid. So we took our vehicle to Spain, and with our proving ground partner, we did something called coast downs. What is a coast down? Coast down is essentially where you bring the vehicle up to a high speed, you then put it into neutral, and you let it roll to a standstill. What does that allow us to do? It allows us to confirm the driving resistances. So how easily does the vehicle roll? How easily does it slip through the air? And what we found was encouraging results. The results were where we expected them to be. So that told us that the virtual world that we were simulating, those results were correct.
Yeah, and such a rollout, some people say rollout, some people say coast down, right? Just to give an imagination to people who are not that much into engineering, it's not rolling for 50 or 100 meters, it's far more than a kilometer, right?
That's right. So when you've got the vehicle up to 140 kilometers per hour, yep. or maximum speed, that vehicle in neutral will roll for yep. a number of kilometers before it comes to a standstill. Yep. Yep. So we have to pick a location that's got a big track yep. that allows you to roll for a long time.
Yep.
We also roll the vehicle in both directions to compensate for vehicle for the track gradient and the side winds, crosswinds that we might see.
So a very scientific approach.
Right? And we have to choose a location where the ambient temperature is quite high, so it has to be above 5 degrees. Right. Hence why we went to our testing partner in Spain.
And this results from the coast down we need for a so-called WLTP, right? And also for all those people out there who don't know exactly what that is, maybe you can explain that in a way that we can understand it.
Yeah, I'll try to make that a bit easier. So WLTP, what does that stand for? It stands for Worldwide Harmonized Light Duty Test Procedure. A bit of a mouthful, but essentially it's a test that's been developed to try and quantify accurately real world vehicle driving range and energy consumption. That particular cycle consists of low speed, medium speed, high speed, and extra high speed sections within the drive cycle, which is representative of suburban, so city, urban, rural, and highway driving. So you try to capture a mixture of different types of driving to give you an accurate, a representative driving efficiency and driving range.
And this driving profile, like 1800 seconds, right, is very, very well defined. And in a test, we must follow that exactly, right?
Exactly. 30-minute long test. We have to follow the drive cycle accurately, which I think brings us on to the next topic, which is test location. So once we validated the coast downs, we then brought our vehicle to a climatic wind tunnel. In Sweden, we did chassis dyno testing here in Germany, as well as proving ground testing. Why do we use wind tunnels and chassis dynos? Well, it's because it allows us to control the ambient temperature and the soak temperature of the vehicle very accurately. So we can test to specific boundary conditions. It also means that we can follow this drive cycle, such as WLTP, accurately as well. And in these locations, we ran drive cycles like WLTP, other efficiency drive cycles, but also performance drive cycles, so acceleration tests, gradability tests, such as driving up a mountain, high-speed cruise tests, and also charging tests, so AC charging, DC charging, at a range of different ambient temperatures. And during that phase, we were able to calibrate things like regen braking, thermal control strategies, so that we can get better efficiency, better driving range.
So maybe we can come to that later. So we think there's even more potential later to become even better with the specific consumption, right?
That's right. So what we found so far is we achieved a driving, a WLTP driving efficiency of 14.5 kilowatt hours per 100 kilometers. With the charging losses, that brings us to 16.1 kilowatt hours per 100 kilometers, which validates the numbers that we had simulated and also declared to the public, which was great news. And that gives us confidence that we can actually hit that 305 kilometer range target and indeed better it. So we don't want to declare any numbers today, make any false promises, but we've got very high confidence that we meet that number and actually exceed it.
And in the beginning, we promised one more number to the people. So for example, if there's someone out there saying, I'm not following this WLTP cycle with my car in my practical usage in my life, I'm someone driving more in the city, in the suburban areas, never on the autobahn with that vehicle. So what answer do we have for this kind of driver?
Right, so we have something called city driving efficiency. So it takes the low and medium speed sections from WLTP and we use that to generate a city driving efficiency. Now, compared to the 14.5 kilowatt hours per 100 kilometers that we have for WLTP driving efficiency, for city driving efficiency, we're down at 10.2. So good news for the people that live in the city, your driving range is going to be even higher than the 305 that we talked about.
Yeah, absolutely right. 10.2 kilowatt hours per 100 kilometers is really, really good, right, for people who drive mostly in the city.
Exactly.
Brilliant result, I guess.
Watch this space. I'm sure we'll be able to share a city driving range soon.
Yeah. Okay, so this is not the end of the story, right? So what's coming next?
Right, so we're in the middle of the SVC3 development phase. We've got various steps that we're going to be taking to try and improve that driving efficiency and range further. One of the things is aerodynamics. So the vehicle we have today, our validation series vehicle, as you can see, still got some gaps in the bodywork. As that becomes more mature and those gaps get smaller, our car drag, our vehicle drag becomes better.
Yeah.
The car is able to slip through the air better.
Yeah.
So we should see an improvement in driving resistances there. In addition to that, we've got some decisions we can make about choice of tires and tire pressures. So today we're assuming all season tire with a pressure of 2.5 bar. There's some variables there, that some choices we could make to improve the driving resistance further. We've got optimization of the thermal system, the control strategies there. So when is the best time to start cooling the electric drive unit and the high voltage battery? When is the best time to start heating it? These all contribute to driving efficiency and vehicle range. We've got fine tuning in the energy management system. So when is the sweet spot to start heating, preconditioning the battery mm-hmm. to give the best driving and charging mm-hmm. experience. Mm-hmm. And then other things like, can we reuse the waste heat from the electric drive unit to heat up the high voltage battery more efficiently? Mm-hmm. That's more efficient than using a high voltage mm-hmm. coolant heater. Cold ambient and hot ambient range testing. So we don't just want to do tests at 23 degrees C, which is a WLTP defined ambient temperature. We need to do tests at -7, +35 to make sure that we've got a robust range, mm-hmm. something that doesn't deteriorate mm-hmm. too much when the temperature is hot mm-hmm. or the temperature is cold.
Mm-hmm.
And then last but not least, real world customer mileage accumulation. So we need to go and test this vehicle on the roads, do the types of drive cycles that customers are realistically going to be doing, not just WLTP drive cycles, so that we can validate that our thermal control strategies are well calibrated, the propulsion mm-hmm. calibration is correct, and that our customers get a good driving range mm-hmm. experience. Mm-hmm.
So we learned today that we have very good results so far, yeah, specific consumption with and without charging losses. The range is validated, solar yield is validated, and as we also learned, we even have potential to become even better. So let's work on that, right?
So all of these measures will help us improve driving efficiency and driving range, and in turn, that gives us a better solar range.
Thank you, Olli. Thanks to everyone watching us. Stay tuned. Looking forward to talk to you again.